This is Brian Wood at University of Washington, and in this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I am going to review recent updates to the Department of Health and Human Services Adult and Adolescent Antiretroviral Treatment Guidelines. You can find this guidelines document at the website listed at the bottom of the slide. I will just note that this is my go-to resource for national clinical guidelines for HIV care and management. And today I'm going to focus on some key updates that came to these guidelines as of September 12th, 2024. I'm not going to be able to review every update that the guidelines panel made, but I will focus on some of the key revisions. The first important revision I will review has to do with the list of options for initial antiretroviral regimens for people with HIV. An important update is the guidelines panel decided to move dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine off of the list of recommended initial regimens for most people with HIV. I will note I had been moving away from this option in my clinical practice as well, and I think this change makes sense. Because of the abacavir component in this combination tablet, clinicians always have to do HLA B5701 testing before prescribing this option to make sure a person is not at risk for a life-threatening hypersensitivity reaction. That testing adds cost and delays starting therapy. In addition, there are now very convincing data that abacavir increases the risk of major adverse cardiovascular events. Plus, we have a lot of other options that tend to be smaller pills, tend to be better tolerated in general, and don't require B5701 testing, and don't seem to increase cardiovascular risk in the same way. Another key revision in this most recent update is several regimens are no longer recommended as initial therapy. These regimens include those that have cobicistat-boosted elvitegravir, those that have raltegravir, boosted darunavir, efavirenz, or the rilpivirine TDF-FTC combination. The reason these are no longer recommended as initial therapy is variable. For some, it's higher pill burden. For some, it's lower barrier to resistance or more adverse effects as compared to the dolutegravir or bictegravir options that are currently recommended. So this is the list of initial regimens for most people with HIV as the HHS guidelines panel outlines them. I want to emphasize that this particular list is for people who have never received injectable cabotegravir as pre-exposure prophylaxis or PrEP. So an important question anytime you're seeing somebody newly diagnosed with HIV or someone who has not yet started ART is to ask them if they have ever received cabotegravir. This list of options has really been simplified. So again, the dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine option has been moved off this list. So now the options to consider are bictegravir, tenofovir, alafenamide, emtricitabine, or dolutegravir with tenofovir-based NRTI therapy, such as tenofovir, alafenamide, emtricitabine, or tenofovir DF, emtricitabine, or tenofovir DF, lamivudine. In addition, in the last row here, you can see that dolutegravir lamivudine two-drug therapy is a reasonable option to consider for initial ART, but it is recommended to only prescribe this option if a person's viral load is below 500,000 copies, if they already have laboratory testing confirming they do not have hepatitis B co-infection, and if you already have the genotype resistance results in hand. For these reasons, and because waiting for all of these results tends to delay the initiation of therapy, for me, I have not prescribed this two-drug option as initial ART very often, or really, if at all, but I have recommended this option for certain individuals as a switch or maintenance option once their viral load is suppressed on more traditional three-drug therapy, especially if there is a strong reason to switch off of TAF or TDF, and especially if they do not have hepatitis B. I see hepatitis B as a really key contraindication to this two-drug option, but it is reasonable to consider as initial therapy. Now, for people who do have a history of ever receiving cabotegravir as pre-exposure prophylaxis, who are then diagnosed with HIV, there is concern that ongoing low levels of cabotegravir in their system at the time of acquiring HIV could lead to HIV infection that has resistance to the integrase inhibitor class of ARVs. For that reason, the guidelines panel outlines two options as initial ART therapy in the setting of prior cabotegravir PrEP use. One would be starting boosted darunavir along with tenofovir alafenamide or tenofovir DF plus emtricitabine or lamivudine, and that could be done pending genotype resistance results. Alternatively, one could wait for genotype resistance results that includes testing for integrase inhibitor resistance, and then if it is confirmed that there are no major integrase resistance mutations, one could start one of the dolutegravir or bictegravir recommended first-line options. For me, I tend to favor starting ART as soon as possible after diagnosis, assuming the person is ready and that's in line with their goals. So here, I think it would be very reasonable if a person diagnosed with HIV has a history of receiving cabotegravir to prescribe something like darunavir, cobicistat, TAF-FTC, which is one pill a day, along with all of the other baseline blood testing, send an integrase resistance test. And then if that test shows an absence of major integrase resistance, then switch therapy to one of the first-line bictegravir or dolutegravir-based options. But here, there's some shared decision-making with the patient that would be necessary. This is the updated list of initial ART regimens to consider in certain clinical situations. Again, this assumes a person has never received cabotegravir as pre-exposure prophylaxis. We talked about reasons that dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine was moved to this list. In reality, thinking about my own practice, I will just share that I cannot remember the last time I prescribed or recommended this option as initial therapy. I really have gotten away from it. The other options that could be considered would be boosted darunavir with two NRTIs or the NNRTI-based options, doravirine, TDF-3TC, or doravirine with TAF-FTC, or the combination tablet, rilpivirine TAF-FTC, with the caveats that that should only be prescribed if the current CD4 count is above 200 and the current viral load is below 100,000 copies. For me in clinical practice, I have not prescribed any of these as first-line therapy recently. I think there may be clinical situations in which they could be considered. They, again, for me, especially the NNRTI-based options, again, tend to be options that I consider more as switch therapy for individuals who have trouble tolerating the first-line recommended options. This update to the guidelines also includes a added option to consider if a person has developed a virologic failure in the past while receiving an NNRTI-based regimen. Traditionally, around the world, the first-line option in this setting was often boosted darunavir plus two NRTIs, although there are data, and it is now supported to use dolutegravir plus two NRTIs or bictegravir plus two NRTIs in this scenario. What this study did and what led to this addition to the guidelines was investigators compared these options you can see here, boosted darunavir plus two NRTIs, again, traditionally the recommended therapy in this situation, to either boosted darunavir plus dolutegravir as two drug therapy or dolutegravir plus two NRTIs, which has quickly become the standard of care as first line and second line therapy around the world. Of note, the boosted darunavir dolutegravir 2 drug therapy and the dolutegravir plus 2 NRTIs option both were found to be non-inferior in terms of virologic efficacy compared to boosted darunavir plus 2 NRTIs. So really that supports the notion that any of these options could be considered in the setting of NNRTI and NRTI virologic failure and presumably resistance. In the study, not every site had access to genotype resistance testing, so we don't know all of the resistance individuals had before starting these options, but presumably there was a large proportion of NNRTI and NRTI resistance mutations, and the punchline is all of these options seemed effective and could be considered. Now, you may be aware that there are growing data and growing clinical experience for using long-acting cabotegravir rilpivirine for individuals who really struggle to take oral ART despite a lot of adherence support, and for individuals who have detectable viral loads. Those individuals were not included in the initial registrational randomized controlled trials of cabotegravir rilpivirine injectable therapy, but a number of centers around the country and around the world have been able to engage people with a lot of adherence support and help them succeed with this therapy. So clinical experience is growing. There are a lot of factors to consider here. One certainly must consider a lot of clinical factors, a lot of factors around resource and available support to help a person succeed with this therapy. But on an individualized and case-by-case basis, it can be considered. And the guidelines panel has now added this language that you can read here, which helps to support use of this therapy, again, on a case-by-case basis with a lot of shared decision-making. The panel also included some updates about hepatitis B co-infection. I will just highlight a few. Pegylated interferon is no longer recommended because of the side effects and very low tolerability. And luckily, most of us have gotten away from using that for hep B. The guidelines panel recommends screening for hepatitis D infection in all people with HIV hep B co-infection. The reason is presence of hepatitis D may accelerate the progression to advanced liver disease, to cirrhosis, and to hepatocellular carcinoma. So if you identify someone who has HIV and hep B complicated by hepatitis D co-infection as well, you may want to monitor more closely if the hepatitis D does seem to be active and contributing to progression. There are not a lot of treatment options in this country right now. This is a situation where pegylated interferon could be considered, but the hope is also that we will have simple, better tolerated hepatitis D treatment options in the future. So the recommendation from the guidelines panel is to screen for hep D in all people with HIV hep B. The other thing the guidelines panel really underscores in this update is that if you are switching ART and that ART regimen change involves a switch off of TAF or off of TDF, or potentially also off of emtricitabine lamivudine, meaning switching off of hepatitis B treatment drugs, then you really need to consider a person's hepatitis B status and their risk of hepatitis B reactivation or hepatitis B flare. So the guidelines emphasize that clinicians should always screen for hepatitis B before considering an NRTI regimen switch, should recommend vaccination if a person is not immune, and if a person is found to have hepatitis B co-infection, their ART really should include TAF, TDF, or entecavir. And this is a situation where if you have questions about the optimal hepatitis B therapy, reaching out to a hepatitis B HIV co-infection expert would always be appropriate. This is also a situation where I think we need more data and more guidance on the clinical scenario of a person who doesn't have active hepatitis B co-infection. They don't have a positive surface antigen, but they do have a positive core antibody, meaning there is some low but non-zero risk of reactivation with a regimen switch. So we will look out for more data and more guidance on that clinical scenario in the future. The section on HIV TB co-infection was also updated in some ways. I will just note a couple of updates. Here is a table of the preferred latent TB treatment options and the ART anchor drugs that can be considered with potential considerations to changing the dosing for drugs like raltegravir or dolutegravir. And I would encourage you to read the footnote here. The guidelines panel has updated the language around the interaction between rifamycins and TAF We know that the rifamycins decrease the concentrations of TAF in the plasma and in the PBMCs, but PK data from healthy volunteers suggests that the level of TAF in the PBMCs likely remains clinically effective. And so if clinicians decide to combine these two drugs, rifamycin and TAF, the guidelines panel recommends monitoring the viral load more closely than usual. That is a clinical situation in which I think all effective options need to be considered, and a lot of conversation and shared decision-making with the patient is important to choose the ART and the latent TB therapy that they are most likely to be successful taking. This is a continuation of the table of options for latent TB therapy and the antiretroviral therapy considerations. And one important note that was new in this iteration of the guidelines was with the 1HP latent TB therapy option, which is 1 month of daily INH and rifapentine, dolutegravir had not previously been recommended, but based on PK data, the guidelines panel has updated this recommendation to say that dolutegravir 50 milligrams twice daily can be considered for those who are already suppressed on 50 milligrams once daily, and that twice daily dosing should be considered for 2 weeks after completing 1HP. Now, I will just note if a person is already receiving dolutegravir twice daily because of other drug-drug interactions or because of integrase resistance, then this would not be an option. So this increased dosing of dolutegravir to 50 milligrams twice daily should only be considered for those who are already suppressed on the 50 milligrams once per day dose. Now, there is also a new section in the guidelines on transplantation for people with HIV. I think this is a really important new section. If it is relevant for any of the patients in your practice, I would encourage you to read it in more detail. I will only include a couple of highlights here, including that people with HIV who are eligible for transplantation should have equitable access. Transplantation for people with HIV requires care by a multidisciplinary team. In addition to being up to date on vaccines, one must consider a person's antiretroviral drug regimen, their prior resistance and ARV options, their adherence, and the potential for drug-drug interactions, especially with immunosuppressing medications that follow transplant. And adjustments may be needed to the antiretroviral drug regimen, but that is going to depend on resistance history, options, and of course, those potential interactions. So to summarize, in this update to the HHS guidelines for adult and adolescent antiretroviral treatment, the list of options for what to start or for initial ART has been simplified. It no longer includes dolutegravir, bacavir, lamivudine. Dolutegravir plus boosted darunavir dual ART has been added as an option that could be considered following virologic failure on an NNRTI plus two NRTI combination. The guidelines panel emphasizes the importance of screening for hepatitis B prior to an ART switch, especially if switching off TAF or TDF. And these guidelines also include important updates to the sections on co-infections. They include a new section on transplantation for people with HIV, and there are also other key revisions I didn't have time to review today, so I would encourage you to look at the guidelines yourself as well.
The production of this national HIV curriculum mini lecture was supported by grant U10HA32104 from the Health Resources and Services Administration of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Its contents are solely the responsibility of the University of Washington IDEA program and do not necessarily represent the official views of HRSA or HHS.